My name is Christine Lang, and I am an assistant professor and SDSU Consumer Horticulture Extension Specialist. And today we are standing in the South Dakota State University Specialty Crop Research Field, and we are here to talk about cover crops being used as living mulch for pepper and broccoli production.
We have three different clover types and a bare ground control. So we have a cura clover, a white clover, and a red clover.
And we're comparing the performance of those clovers and the performance of cash crops, primarily peppers and broccoli, in those different clover systems as compared to a bare ground plot, which would be the control in this study. The reason we're pursuing this study is I was receiving questions from gardeners as well as commercial specialty crop producers about what types of cover crops to use in their farm or garden systems and how they might be able to integrate that within their vegetable production system. So that's why we're looking specifically at clovers, because they can be seeded really early in the spring or they can be seeded in the fall. These are perennial crops, so they will overwinter in most cases, barring any extremes.
These cover crops were selected partly because farmers have expressed an interest in systems that will provide nitrogen without extra fertilization.
The goal of this research, again, is to understand the crop performance of the living mulch, which is the clovers, in their ability to suppress weeds, to keep that soil covered, prevent erosion. And clover cover crops are in the legume family, so they have a relationship with soil bacteria that results in fixation of atmospheric nitrogen, so those clovers can actually contribute nitrogen back into the soil system. Now, questions remain about how to best establish these clovers, what the planting rates should look like, and are we going to have extreme nitrogen competition or moisture competition with a cash crop such as broccoli or peppers. What we're finding in year one of this study, in a droughty year such as 2022, where we haven't had the most consistent of rainfalls, the clover has definitely been competing with the cash crop for moisture.
If we look across the plots, it's actually the plots without the cover crop that are doing best right now. And part of the reason for that is the first year clover is planted, it doesn't necessarily contribute a lot of nitrogen back to the soil. We may see differences in the second year, but right now it's just kind of competing with the crop, and that's something that farmers need to know. What can they expect if they plant as we have here?
And that's important data to gather for better or for worse, so that we can help farmers make an informed decision about whether this might be the best practice for them to use on their farm. Another thing we're tracking is the management system of the soil in the rows itself. So different rows have been managed differently. So we have some rows where we have tilled, and we have rows where we haven't tilled. And then in addition to that, we're using black woven fabric or no black woven fabric. So we're also very interested in the in-row production system. And for example, the field right here that I'm standing in, this is one of our white clover plots, and the broccoli that's right in front of me is really truly in the living mulch system, where it hasn't been tilled and that clover cover crop was never removed. And one thing that's pretty evident looking at this plot is that the broccoli is not growing as large and is being outcompeted. So there are some things that we would really maybe like to work for these living mulch systems, but we're realizing that we're going to need to have a tillage pass or have some space so that we can limit the clover cover crop competition immediately in the row with the broccoli.
The same study was replicated in two other areas down in Beersford and out West River near Myrtle. And unfortunately, in their other two locations, in a drought year, the clover just did not establish very well. So that's another thing that we've learned from the study is what will and won't work for us across South Dakota.
I think it's really important to remember with field research that we need to gather multiple years of data before we can say definitively, this is a great idea, or this is going to work, or by golly, you really shouldn't do this on your farm. So while year one has had some good things that have come out of it, and we've had some challenges, we're really looking ahead to year two, where we're going to work once again to reestablish these clover cover crop plots and we're going to repeat the planting of both the broccoli and the peppers so that we'll have 2+ years of data. Also, these plots are part of a larger research project. We actually do have a field site in Beersford, South Dakota, where we're currently growing squash, and we'll be growing squash again next year there. And we are hoping with these studies to have long-term plots so that we can start to understand what are the soil health implications of growing this clover 3, 4, 5 years on your farm, and can you start to possibly reduce fertility? Can you alleviate some issues with compaction based on, you know, reducing tillage within the row as well? So our goal, while we're not seeing stellar results in year one, our goal is to look at the longer term implications of some of these management systems for commercial vegetable producers in South Dakota. Farmers and gardeners who want to learn more about living mulch systems and how to manage a variety of cover crops for your farm and garden can go to the SDSU Extension website and watch for in-season trial updates through web articles, and also watch for end-of-season trial reports that will have the complete data set to help you make decisions for your farm or garden.